If you happen to be getting into fashion as a dude around 2008 or so, and you lived out west, the chances you knew about Jack Threads was super high. The once flash sales members only company changed into something entirely different by its end, and grave decisions were made to keep it afloat. And even worse ones led to its complete obliteration. Today, we examine what happened, how it happened, and what the company could have done to reverse its fortunes. I'm your boy, Reggie Casual, and this is the rise and fall of Jack Threads. The origins of Jack Threads is like one of those American dream stories you hear about so often that aren't really repeatable as much as they are an example of certain business opportunities being extremely lucrative at the absolute right time. The company, based out of Columbus, Ohio, was started by Ohio State alum Jason Ross, whose interest in streetwear and sneakers led him to creating a site dedicated to guys that would provide them with amazing clothing at pretty healthy discounts. The model was especially useful in 2008, as the Great Recession was slowly recovering and men were exploring fashion at a higher clip than ever before. You could literally point to a time from 2008 to about 2011, 2012, that men's fashion hit a stride that shaped how we approach fashion today. The essentials, the rotation boom happened, and during this time, Jack Threads was pretty much at the center of it. Jack Threads, on its own, managed to acquire 35,000 members with no marketing budget. By the time it started advertising on media company Thrillist, it stood at about 150,000 members. Thrillist, seeing how lucrative Jack Threads was, decided to bet the farm on the company and bought it, which would eventually make Jack Threads the linchpin to its e-commerce offerings. With Thrillist's then user base of 3 million subscribers, the company would leverage these individuals, which eventually catapulted Jack Threads into another stratosphere, bringing that 150,000 membership to 1.6 million members by 2012. The near 20% yearly growth rate for Jack Threads was a phenomenal success. And as menswear and street continued to expand in the market, as did Jack Threads. Or at least that's what I'd like to tell you. Yes, Jack Threads was killing it, and the company had expanded exponentially in a very short time. But like all things, challenges began to present themselves. And with Jack Threads, one of the first issues was quality of product. As the recession woes began to recede and the economy began to normalize and those same guys who were buying into Jack Threads got older, they began to realize that the clothing Jack Threads offered was quite often low quality, unable to sustain wear and tear past a couple of seasons. Add to the fact that streetwear from the bigger brands like Supreme was in its prime, and new brands and designers were putting the onus on flexing, and thus the core market of Jack Threads began to wane and abandon the platform. Seeing that this spelled certain doom for the company, Thrillist, via Jack Threads, did the right thing and responded to the market changes by offering higher tiered and quality clothing, and listing labels like The North Face to be among its list of platform brands. But the problem here was that Jack Threads built its reputation on flash sales and affordable but good-looking clothing, so it alienated a huge chunk of its base and diminished its appeal. It was like they wanted good quality for a cheap price, which is very hard to do. This eventually led to Jack Threads making two of the biggest blunders that ultimately destroyed the company to the point where it couldn't even be sold. That's right, investors wouldn't even touch it with a 10-foot pole. The first thing, Jack Threads would revamp their entire model and image to produce their own clothing and sell it at full price, abandoning the flash sales model and going all in on a higher quality original brand at a fair price point. The second thing, implementing a tryout model that allowed customers to get a package filled with Jack Threads goods from which they could try on and pay for whatever they kept and send back the package of whatever they didn't want. And shipping was free both ways. So yeah, one could see why both of these were massive mistakes on the surface. But before we get into that, let's give you some simple data. During its peak, Jack Threads made upwards to $70 million in a fiscal year. By the time it was dying, it was flailing, pushing at around 30 million a year. Now, you may be thinking, hey, that's 30 million. Basically, this is what happened. They weren't selling enough product compared to internal stock. So essentially, they lost money, even though on paper, they were still making it. It got so bad that the head company, Thrillist, had to split the divisions of Thrillist in half, from e-commerce to media. It was a mess. So, why was the original brand such a terrible concept? Well, it basically alienated a base that wanted variety rather than another brand. And while the flash sales model was out of favor by 2015-2016, JackThreads could have easily turned to up-and-coming mid-tier labels to bolster its offerings so they could have more variety. Possibly, they could have propped up these labels to help get their foot in the door. The flash sales model could have been replaced with a flash brand model, giving labels curated by JackThreads itself to be featured on the site. This would have given more justification to the turn away from flash sales. You would have brands from different price points rather than just saying flash sales or not having it at all, or your own brand. As far as the tryout model, it's been proven that this is a way to lose money fast. Even Nordstrom had a $197 million write-down in 2016 on its try-on concierge service, undermining the gains it had that very year. The tryout model was different, but it proved to be expensive and a huge risk, as people could damage clothes and then send them back with not a worry. And it did happen. A lot. Plus free shipping. Both ways. Here's the thing, fashion exists in its current form because of brick and mortar stores. Yes, I get it, you don't need a brick and mortar shop nowadays, but it certainly is something you should think about when you're making $50 to $70 million a year. Maybe, just maybe, small, intimate JackThreads shops would have gone a long way, even if it was like one or two domestically with special offerings that weren't on the site, especially at the height of JackThreads. As a result of totally neglecting the physical space, it suffered catastrophically. The unfortunate reality is that JackThreads was a victim of right place at the right time, and then too slow to adapt when it mattered most. But this wasn't on former founder Jason Ross. This was on Thrillist, who simply mismanaged JackThreads. The clothing store succeeded because of its flash sales model. And when that model proved to be less popular, they went with another gimmick instead and compounded that by trying to sell their own label, which was frankly the most uninspired brand that by 2017 was absolutely out of step with the style du jour. Trying to go all in on the menswear aesthetic may have worked in 2012 and 2013, but by the mid-2010s and onward, what JackThreads was offering as its brand was like typical I don't care about style menswear and a couple of streetwear shirts. Even the menswear guys abandoned it totally. The brand completely closed shop in 2017, selling everything for like 70% off. Apparently, the site is still operational, but all other socials haven't been updated in years. So ultimately, what could have JackThreads done? Well, to summarize, they could have not wasted money on a tryout gimmick that was unsustainable and could have built actual stores where people could try stuff on, even their own brand. Yeah, it's expensive, but it gives you more flexibility and defines your target market. And that's really what JackThreads should have done. They should have had a distinct target market. JackThreads, at the beginning, targeted men who wanted style for cheap, who liked streetwear to some degree. And who was that? Like, everybody. Sure, that model works when money is tight, like say in a recession, but when people have money, they have more options. And by 2016, those discount happy early 20s guys were now pushing 30. And tastes change a lot during those years, so I've been told. So that's the rise and fall of JackThreads, but maybe something was missed, or maybe you can add a few reasons or ideas on what the company could have done. Let it all be known in the comments. And if you want to join us in on fashion discussion, branding, marketing, or building your own personal or fashion brand, join us on Patreon and get full episodes on our series class, as well as help in our community of brand entrepreneurs in our private Discord. All that stuff. But most importantly, keep it locked right here for all of your info on international street fashion culture and business from Tokyo. It's your boy, and keep it casual. Yoroshiku onegaishimasu, and I'll see you guys in a minute.